Lord God, for allowing us to proclaim that we are yours. And more importantly, Lord, you call us your children. Thank you. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Jesus and Holy Spirit. Thank you. We're blessed. Speak to us today. We thank you for our gathering. We thank you that you're here amongst us. Speak to us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Good morning. All right. Praise the Lord. Anybody have their scripture with them today? Let's proclaim it, shall we? I believe this is the perfected word of God. I believe that in the volume of this book speaks about my Lord and my Savior, Jesus Christ. I desire not only to read it, to know it, but through the power of God's Holy Spirit to live it. Amen? Amen. We read the Bible and pray every day. Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. As we make our way to Acts chapter 14. Anyway, Acts chapter 14. As we left Paul last time around verse 21, we saw Paul was stoned and thrown out of town. And he was left for dead. And we remember last time that we thought Paul was dead. And so some of the disciples and the friends and things, I'm sure they were just gathered around Paul and they were heartbroken. And they couldn't believe it. And I'm sure they were crying and crying out to the Lord and weeping over Paul and just thinking, Lord, how come you allowed our friend to be stoned to death? And the Lord said, I'm not allowed him to be stoned to death. I mean, and before you know it, all of a sudden Paul is resurrected. I mean, he stands to his feet. And so he says, hey, let me go find my partner Barnabas. And so he grabs Barnabas and they headed to Derbe, we saw last time. And during their journeys, during what we call Paul's first missionary journey, he had planted several churches and we saw that he was strengthening, him and Barnabas were kind of making the loop and strengthening the converts. And so we're going to see today, this morning, that Paul's first missionary journey is going to conclude. So as we pick up in Acts chapter 14, verse 24, it reads as follows. After that, Paul and Barnabas passed through Pisidia. They came to Pamphylia. Now when they had preached the word in Perga, they went down to Attalia. From there, they sailed to Antioch, where they had been commended to the grace of God for the work which they had completed. And so we're going to once again check in with our map here, if I can draw your attention to the PowerPoint, just to kind of get our legs back under us, be reminded along with our Bible study. We're also getting our geography study here. We remember that in this area there were two Antiochs, and we've identified the two Antiochs as Syrian Antioch, kind of to the side of the slide, and then to the north of the slide we see the Pisidian Antioch, if you will. And of course we were reminded they ran out of names, and so they had to call these towns by the same name, and it can be very confusing. So hopefully this helps us a little bit. But the Syrian Antioch was Paul's headquarters, if you will. We remember they left from Syrian Antioch, went about their journey, and now we're going to see this morning that they're going to head back to Syrian Antioch. In other words, back to headquarters. And so as they're heading back to the headquarters, they're stopping by and checking in with the fellowships, as we've seen consistent throughout our teaching through the book of Acts. And so as we pick up at verse 27, now when Paul and Barnabas had come and gathered the church together, they reported all that God had done with them and that he had opened the door of faith to the Gentiles. And so that open door of faith that's being commented on here was revealed, we remember, in Acts chapter 10. We remember when Peter was on the housetop coming before the Lord in prayer and fasting, and the Lord revealed himself to Peter in a vision. And Peter was essentially, as we just cut to the chase, told to go to this man Cornelius' house. And now Cornelius was a Gentile, a Roman citizen, a Roman soldier. But yet Cornelius was searching for the Lord with all his heart, we remember in chapter 10. And so Peter was given the commission, we recall. Peter was the one to come to this Gentile and speak the word of the Lord to Cornelius. Now, interestingly, and we don't want to get confused, salvation of the Lord has always been for all mankind. The problem is that when salvation was put into mankind's hands, humankind's hands, we goofed it up. See, the Jews were really the ones that were supposed to bring the good news. But in their mind, they couldn't figure out why would the Gentiles be included with this good news. And that was humankind's fault. Often we see mistakes in the Bible, and just because we see an activity in Scripture, it doesn't always mean it's of the Lord. Case in point, when the Lord introduced marriage to us in the book of Genesis, the Lord proclaimed one man and one woman. Praise the Lord. Now, nowhere throughout Scripture do we find that being compromised except through man's foolishness. It wasn't compromised by God. God didn't come later and say, oh, I made a mistake, or I'm going to go with the contemporary times and change my opinion. No, one man, one woman. But the mistake was, is once we saw very early in the Old Testament that men were taking multiple wives. Now, nowhere in Scripture did God say that was okay, but it was going on. But it wasn't God's design. So there, case in point, just because something is going on in Scripture, it doesn't mean it's of the Lord. The Jews were to bring the good news, but they hoarded it. They kept it to themselves. The Jews were to reach out to the Gentiles from day one, but they didn't do it in an aggressive way. There was a hatred to the Gentiles, to the Greeks. And the Jews didn't want to see the Gentiles saved. And so this is not to say that, oh, God had an idea to save the Gentiles in Acts chapter 10. No, God is just trying to clean up the mess that's been going on for generations. And of course, we've seen Gentiles in the sanctuary all throughout the book of Acts, the teaching of Acts. We see that there were mixed multitudes. But again, the Jew was trying to put the Gentile down, but the Lord was not having it. And that's why the Lord picked Peter, a good Jewish boy, and said, you need to go preach the gospel to this Gentile family, Cornelius' household. And so Peter obediently received that direction, and he did so. And so once again, now Paul is rejoicing, saying, hey, let's check this out. The Lord has opened the door, is continuing to open the door to the Gentiles. And again, this is nothing that's new, but it's a news flash to the Jew. Why is it that we goof up the gospel, the simplicity of the gospel? How is it that we make it so complicated that people aren't coming to the Lord? That's sad. But you know what? We're going to be accountable for that. That's not good. That's bad. So thankfully, we're here on a weekly basis, and we're able to kind of find out and realize, man, the good news is for everybody. Just as Pastor Vince was saying, hey, you know, it's not easy for me to pray for this guy that pulled the trigger, but you know what? It's our job. We're supposed to do it. Now, we can't do it under our own power. We can only do it through the Spirit of God. So can we begin to get out of the way of the Spirit of the Lord and allow Him to move through us? I know that's our desire. And that's why we're here. We're demonstrating that. And so that's just confirming our desire. The Lord is saying, yes, I'm going to meet you right where you're at today. Amen. And that's exciting. This is good stuff. And so Paul and Barnabas, they're reporting all that God had done with them. Hey, we traveled around, man. We gave the good news, and you know what? God is opening doors. And so they're reporting, and they're excited. And so in verse 28, so they stayed there. Paul and Barnabas stayed there a long time with the disciples. And so they're in Syrian Antioch with the other disciples. And of course, there's fellowship. There's things going on. People are excited. Hey, this is what the Lord's doing. And I have a feeling that these Jewish brethren are kind of thinking, is that of the Lord? And then all of a sudden, they kind of got it. They said, so be it. So be it. Let's open the good news to our Gentile friends. And that's what these disciples are coming to that conclusion and saying, great. If this is what the Lord wants to do, outstanding. And so the excitement is brewing. And then we continue through in chapter 15, verse 1. But of course, here comes our friends from Judea. We're familiar with these guys. Certain men came down from Judea and taught the brethren, unless you are circumcised according to the custom of Moses, you cannot be saved. Wow. Can we take a bold step backward for a moment? We okay with that? Picture Jesus on the cross. Picture the two thieves on either side. And all these three men's lives are coming to a close. Their lives on earth, I should say. And the one criminal with a pure heart turns toward Jesus and said, Jesus, would you remember me as you enter into your kingdom this day? This man was confessing, Jesus, you are king. And you are the rightful king of heaven. That's what this criminal was saying. And Jesus, I'm not worthy, but would you just think of me? When you enter into paradise, would you just think of me? Just give me a thought. And Jesus turned to this man. He said, this day you will enter in with me into paradise. Now, is there anywhere that Jesus said, you know what, I'd love to take you into paradise, but you're not circumcised, brother. Sorry, man. Bro, you missed heaven by that much. Are you kidding? Where do we come up with this stuff? I mean, these guys come down from Judea. Oh, yeah, you gotta be circumcised. Where do we come up with this stuff? Oh, if you're not baptized, well, can't go to heaven. Where do we get this? It's a misunderstanding of Scripture. We misrepresent the truth. We don't understand the truth. And in a way, it's kind of a power grab also. We're trying to control people. I mean, the Jews just couldn't handle it. They said, well, Gentiles coming to the Lord and having freedom in Christ? I don't know. You think they can handle it? I don't think they can. Well, let's put some restrictions on them. That's not the Lord. That is not the finished work of Jesus Christ, is it? It's crazy talk. Crazy talk. And in verse 2, as we continue, therefore, when Paul and Barnabas, when they heard this, they had no small dissension and dispute with them. In other words, Paul and Barnabas stood right up and said, wait a minute. Hold up. Wrong. And they determined, and so the folks around Paul and Barnabas, the folks in this group, determined that Paul and Barnabas and certain others of them should go up to Jerusalem to the apostles and the elders about this question. Okay, so we've got an issue here. That's not the problem. We've got to get some counsel on this. Let's send you guys up to Jerusalem. Now, those of you that are going to be joining us on our Israel trip in January 2018, if there's plenty of seats open, we'd love to have you, and it's a trip of a lifetime. So please, if you feel like you would desire to go to Jerusalem, go to Israel with us, man, we'd love to have you. We're going to have a blast. Plenty of time to start saving your pennies and join us. But for those of us that will be going to Israel, and then when we get around the neighborhood of Jerusalem, the first thing you notice is that you always go up to Jerusalem, because Jerusalem is on a hill, on Mount Zion. You always go up. As we just open up the Psalms on Wednesday night, eventually, as the Lord permits, we will get to the Hallel Psalms. That's when the men were heading up to Jerusalem, and they were rejoicing and praising the Lord that they got to go and meet with Yahweh, Jehovah. Man, we're going to meet God, and we're so excited. We're going up to Jerusalem. And you know, those of you that are desiring to go to Israel with us, you know what? You don't even have to be circumcised. How about that for freedom, huh? This nonsense about being circumcised, yada, yada. I mean, where do we come up with this stuff? Is it one of these nights that we can't sleep and we're just running these things through our minds? It's crazy. And so they're going to send an entourage. They're going to send Paul and Barnabas to Judea and to Jerusalem, and they were sending a little entourage. And on their way, so as this entourage is taking off in verse 3, being sent on their way by the church, so the Syrian Antioch group sent Paul and everybody, they passed through Phoenicia and Samaria. So once again, if we could pull our map back up, Phoenicia and Samaria we see is down at the bottom of the PowerPoint here. Phoenicia and Samaria, this is where this entourage, so starting from Antioch, Syrian Antioch, heading south, heading toward Jerusalem, they would pass through these little cities. Now, as they passed through Phoenicia and Samaria, they described the conversion of the Gentiles, and they caused great joy to all the brethren. And so as Paul and Barnabas and this entourage were working their way south, they were on what we would consider the shoe leather express, amen? Come on. I mean, there was no Uber, no Lyft, no dial-a-ride. The shoe leather express. And so as this entourage is heading south, they would at times pick up other travelers. I mean, you're putting along, and being a traveler yourself back in these days, you would like going in a group, because in that group, it would represent safety. You know, there's safety in numbers, right? So you see some guy, hey, where are you guys heading? Well, we're heading south. Great, I am too. Mind if I join you? Of course not. Come on in. What's your name? What's going on? And stuff. And so it was for safety. It was for fellowship. It was for conversation. Wonderful stuff. Kind of get caught up on the latest news. Now, who here has ever hitchhiked? Huh? Who's that old? I mean, I was 13 or 14 years old before I got my driver's license. That's how I got around. I hitchhiked, right? We used to call it thumbing it. You remember that? We used to call it thumbing it. And that's how I'd come down the hill from Idlewild, growing up in Idlewild, and I'd have to come down into the big city, Hemet. And the way I would get down the hill is I'd be thumbing it. You know, and so, you know, a car would drive by and they'd see me out there thumbing it and they'd pull over. Hey, and we'd join together. I mean, we'd have fellowship. We'd have communication. Hey, where are you going? Well, I'm going down to Hemet. Well, I am too, you know. Great, we'll take you on down the hill. Now, sometimes in those days of thumbing it and stuff, some people had no idea where they were going. I just want to get out of here, you know. I mean, sometimes we felt so crummy about the area that we were at. We're like, man, just get me out of here. I don't care where I'm going. Get me out of here. Remember sometimes, too, with the cardboard, the guys used to write west. I mean, guys, they heard about San Francisco and things. They said, man, west. I'm just going west. You know, take me as far as you're going. And then now with Paul and Barnabas, they knew where they were going, just like some of our other hitchhikers knew exactly where they were going. In the next slide here. Paul and Barnabas knew exactly where they were going. And when they had come to Jerusalem, verse 4, they were received by the church and by the apostles and the elders. And so they made it to Jerusalem, and they were received. Like, great, our journey is over. And they reported all things that God had done with them. In other words, their message, Paul and Barnabas's message was, hey, salvation of the Lord is not an exclusive thing. It's not to be just contained in our little Jewish community. Paul and Barnabas, these good Jewish boys, they're saying, oh no, salvation is for all mankind. It's not exclusive. And man, they're excited. They're reporting this with great zeal and joy. These guys are happy. Man, they're excited. They're excited. But there again, in verse 5, we run into our little three-letter word again that we've seen often over the past few weeks. But. I mean, everything's going great, but. But some of the sect of the Pharisees, verse 5, who believed, rose up. Now, these are believers. But they rose up saying, it is necessary to circumcise them, in other words, these Gentile believers, and to command them to keep the law of Moses. Now, the Pharisees, quite simply, very simply for this morning, the Pharisees were just, we can consider them strict law abiders. They were lawyers. They knew the law. But they were so engaged in the law, they had to be retrained concerning grace. Grace is what this church is all about. Grace is what God's will is all about. You know, while you and I were yet sinners, Christ died for us. In other words, while we were doing this to the Lord, in other words, while I was throwing rocks at the CMA, Christ died for me. That's undeserved. I didn't deserve it. I didn't deserve it. You didn't deserve it. All have sinned, we understand, and fall short of the glory of God. That's the way we were born. We're born sinners. As we're going through Psalm 51, opening up the Sunday services, we're going to find out that David admits, hey, I was born in sin. And he fesses it up. He fesses it up. He says, I was born in sin, and I'm just demonstrating that I'm a sinner. That's what Psalm 51 is all about. But yet, undeserved favor, grace, is given without abundance, with total abundance, to you and I. And so these strict law abiders were saying, well, we're glad to hear that they've come to the Lord through Jesus, but they still need to be circumcised, and they still need to follow the law of Moses. Have you ever heard that idea, and people giving this idea of, like, it's Jesus plus, it's Jesus and, it's not Jesus plus, it's not Jesus and, it's Jesus, period. It's the finished work of what Jesus Christ did. And you know what? For women, it's easier for women to receive that, but for us as guys, because we're so prideful, we say, oh no, I don't want any charity, I'll do it for myself. Oh no, we don't take freebies at our house. No, we work here. There's something in the human wiring that we cannot receive that idea of Jesus only. We can say Jesus and a bunch of works. Okay, I can live with that. We can say Jesus and I'll give a bunch of money. Yeah, I can live with that. That's not what it is. Now, as we're saved and as the Lord reveals himself to us throughout our lives, we then are motivated to do things. And we desire, we love to do things for the Lord. We love to do things for people. We love to help out in certain circumstances and things. But that's just a motivation, the motivational result of our salvation. We're saved by the finished work of Christ, and that's it. When people ask that question, oh, if the rapture happens and I'm committing a sin, will I go in the rapture? When are you not sinning? Really? When are you not sinning? When are you not thinking about something in your mind? And then, oh, the rapture came. Well, three people went in the rapture. Right? Wouldn't be much of a rapture. Jesus died for us for our past, our present, and our future. Now, we sin less, we desire, you know, we get convicted, rightfully so, and we respond to that conviction. Man, Lord, you're right. You know, you need to help me in this area. Lord, I'm still struggling. I'm still struggling. Holy Spirit, I need the fruit coming out of my life. I need to erase those thoughts. I need to get that stuff out of my heart. I need to quit doing that activity. You're right, Lord. You're right. But I know my salvation is secure. As long as I stay close to you, Jesus, I'm secure, right? And he says, absolutely. It's a non-issue. It's a done deal. So these guys are saying, hey, I'm glad they're saved, but they need to be circumcised and they need to keep the law of Moses. Boy, this is some tough stuff. Peter, involved in this group, I mean, this is a group of men speaking. And the apostles in verse 6, the apostles and the elders came together to consider this matter. And that's why, of course, we're reminded Paul and Barnabas are here to discuss this matter. In verse 7, and when there had been much dispute, in other words, there were voices raised, there was some yelling and shouting and perhaps some clenched fists likewise. When there had been much dispute, Peter rose up and said to them. So Peter's been sitting in this group this whole time, kind of listening, keeping his mouth shut. And then when there was a little bit of a lull in the conversation, Peter rose up and said to them, men and brethren, you know that a good while ago God chose among us that by my mouth, Peter speaking, the Gentiles should hear the word of the gospel and believe. And so Peter's going right back to Cornelius, back to what we would reference as Acts chapter 10. Peter's saying, hey, you remember the household of Cornelius? Sure you do. So he continues in verse 8, so God, who knows the heart, acknowledged Cornelius' family by giving them the Holy Spirit, just as he did to us. Peter is saying, God has not withheld anything to the Gentiles that he has given to us. We better learn to wrap our arms around that, fellas. That's what Peter's saying. We better get with it here. He gave them the Holy Spirit just as he did to us, verse 9, and made no distinction between us and them, purifying their hearts by faith. How do we receive this grace? Paul tells us in Ephesians chapter 2. You receive God's grace through faith. Oh, and by the way, he gives you that measure of faith also. If you're sitting here this morning and you have not been saved by grace, you better ask God for that seed of faith, and he'll give it to you. If you say, Lord God, I want that seed of faith so I can receive the grace, the finished work, so I can believe in the finished work of your son Jesus Christ, I want to make him my Savior today. You're going to get an opportunity to do that today as we begin to close. No distinction between us and them. Jesus, the Lord God, purified their hearts by faith. Verse 10, as we begin to close, now therefore, Peter concluding, therefore, why do you, hey, my friends, my brothers, why do you test God? And that's a mouthful. Why do you test God? Why do you test God by putting a yoke on the neck of the disciples, which neither our fathers nor we were able to bear? Why do you want to chain these folks down? Why? And Peter's just being very open and honest. Why would you even consider that? Why would you put that burden on these new believers? It's not of the Lord at all. You better be careful. We weren't able to bear that burden, nor why would they be expected to bear it? And finally, Peter concludes, But we believe that through the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, not Jesus and, not Jesus plus, the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, in that we shall be saved, they shall be saved in the same manner as they. We shall be saved in the same manner as they. Amen. There's no difference. There's one way to God. He makes it simple. See, he doesn't make it complicated. He says, hey, you come to me through the finished work of my son, Jesus Christ, God the Son. That's simple. But yet we try to complicate it. Oh, there's a bunch of different ways. Well, that's confusing. Because if there was a bunch of different ways, we'd say, well, which way is right? Oh, any of them. Well, that's confusing. So the Lord God said, no, there's one simple way. That's it. It's simple. God help us that have confused and complicated the issue. And we find that all throughout. The sect of the Pharisees is kind of stirring the pot, confusing the issue. And Peter's clearing it up. Oh, no, it's through Jesus Christ. We're saved in the same manner as they. That's it. It's simple. And that's a nice thing to hear today, isn't it? Amen. What a great way to start our week. Amen? Amen? I could ask the worship team to come join me. The biggest problem we have in Christianity today, in my opinion, is that we don't understand grace. Oh, we use the term here and there. We flip it around. Toss it around. Oh, yeah, grace, grace. But when it comes down to applying unmerited favor in someone else's life, that's where we kind of struggle, don't we? Oh, we can do anything. We can do no wrong in our lives because we're covered by grace. But when it's someone else, we have a difficulty applying that same unmerited favor. And we can only operate that through the fruits of the Spirit. That's the only way. It's not a natural thing. It's a difficult thing. It's an impossible thing in the flesh. But why is it so difficult to ask the Lord, Lord, would you allow your Spirit just to work through me? Why is that so tough? But it is. We have to admit that is tough for us. There's a lot of pride going on in our lives. God help us cleanse ourselves from that. And we can only do it through your conviction to start with, and then allowing you to move in our lives, and then eventually let it work out of our lives. Amen. Are you here this morning? It's the first time you've ever heard about this idea of the finished work of Christ. Is that you this morning? Do you need Jesus? You know who you are. I don't know who you are. God knows who you are. But this morning, would you just acknowledge by raising your hand, just saying, you know what? I don't have Jesus. And I need him today. I've been complicating salvation, and I need Jesus. I want to confess that. I want to move away from that. Is that you this morning? Just raise your hand. Simply raise your hand. And that's the, God bless you. Put your hand down. Praise the Lord. Anybody else? Want to pray for the sister in the Lord? Anybody else need Christ? Today's your day. I'm going to go home tonight. I'm going to pillow my head in absolute peace because I've given the gospel. But I pray if you don't have Jesus this morning and as you leave and go out throughout your day today, unlike my sister here, but if you leave today without Christ, I pray the Holy Spirit just convicts and bugs you all day long. But my sister in the Lord, we'll talk with you a little bit more after the service, but Paul tells us in the book of Romans 10:9-10, as you believe in your heart and you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord, Scripture tells us you will be saved. And so that's what you've postured yourself and positioned yourself to do that this morning. And so if you just repeat after me, just a very simple prayer. But make it your own. Allow the Lord to hear from your heart as we pray together. Just repeat after me. Dear Lord Jesus, I turn from my sin and I turn to your Son, Jesus Christ. I thank you for the conviction that you've given me this day. And now as I ask you, Jesus, to come into my heart, and I confess with my mouth that you are Lord, according to your word, I am saved. Praise the Lord. Welcome to the family of God. We're going to have a couple of the ladies come with some information to help you out, to assist you in your new journey. We want you to make sure that you get plugged in to a good Bible-teaching, Bible-believing church. We're going to give you some materials to help you with that. But again, welcome. God bless you. You've changed your whole life, and we're grateful to be a small part of that. But welcome. Praise the Lord. God bless you. And that was the excitement that Paul and Barnabas, as they were hitchhiking around, if you will, they were sharing that. Hey, man, people are coming to the Lord, and it's exciting. And that's what we've joined together here this morning. We've prayed. We've assembled. We've lifted our hands, our hearts, and our voices unto the Lord. So let's continue to worship the Lord. I pray God reveals himself to you in a mighty way today. The things that you've been praying and asking the Lord, I pray that he just reveals it to you in a wonderful way. That time that you know that you know that you know that this is of the Lord, I pray that that's an abundance throughout your week this week. Have a great week in the Lord. If you need prayer, we'll meet you up front. If you need coffee, we'll meet you in the lobby. And please take a minute and stop by the Christian Motorcycle Association. Encourage them. They're out on the front lines. They need your prayers. They need your love. They need your connection. We'll see you Wednesday with pure worship. Wednesday night, a kickback night of large amounts of praise and worship music. And then we will also break bread on that Wednesday night, this coming Wednesday night. Let's go out praising the Lord, shall we? Let's sing, sing, sing.
I will sing, sing, sing to my God.